Now, homeostasis is one of the concepts that we'll talk more about together in class. But the important thing to point out for right now is that homeostasis is maintained through a process called negative feedback. When some biological parameter, like body temperature, fluctuates too far away from the set point, it creates a stimulus. A stimulus can get detected by a receptor, which is usually part of the nervous system, and then it will get sent to a controller, like your brain. Later on, we'll call that whole process sensation. The job of the controller is to compare the stimulus to the set point and activate an effector that coordinates some kind of response inside the body. Now, in order to maintain homeostasis, the response must be a negative feedback response. And that means that the response has to decrease the stimulus. We can look at the example of body temperature in the diagram on the right here. If body temperature increases, then receptors for temperature in your skin, called thermoreceptors, will relay a signal to your brain. Your brain will then activate effectors like sweat glands to produce sweat, and your blood vessels will dilate. This increases the evaporation and heat loss at the surface of your skin, which will reduce your body temperature. Now, since this response reduces the initial stimulus, which was an increase in temperature, this is known as negative feedback. It returns your body to a state of thermal homeostasis. Positive feedback loops also exist, although they're much less common inside the body. In fact, we're only going to see a few examples of positive feedback in our entire course. And that's because positive feedback loops take you out of homeostasis. In other words, positive feedback loops create responses that amplify the stimulus. So one example of positive feedback occurs during childbirth. When a baby is being delivered, it stretches out the smooth muscle in the cervix and activates stretch receptors. These stretch stimuli are sent to the brain, which will respond by releasing the hormone oxytocin. Oxytocin stimulates the contraction of smooth muscle in the female reproductive system, and that pushes the baby further down the birth canal. But when the baby moves further down the birth canal, more stretching occurs, and that leads to the release of more oxytocin, which leads to the release of more smooth muscle contraction, which eventually causes more stretching. So you see where we're going with this. It's an amplification type of effect. The response amplifies the stimulus. Now, because positive feedback loops are very disruptive to homeostasis, they often require some kind of external factor from outside of the system to turn them off. So in this example, the outside factor is the baby getting delivered and removed from the birth canal. Both positive and negative feedback loops take place in what's known as a closed system, which means that there's a relationship between the stimulus and the response, and either increases it or decreases it. In open systems, also known as feed-forward responses, there's no relationship between the stimulus and the response. So in this picture of what looks like Humpty Dumpty chasing a bus, we're trying to represent a situation that we've all experienced, where you walk out of your house and you see your bus driving away from the bus stop without you on it. This causes an instant increase in your heart rate. It also increases your respiration rate. But you're breathing heavy and your heart is pounding out of your chest, but it's still not going to bring the bus back to the bus stop. It's also not going to prevent you from seeing the bus pulling away from you. So therefore, there's no relationship between the stimulus and your response. Now, feed-forward mechanisms are weird. Sometimes they happen without any particular rhyme or reason, but in other times, like in the example that I just gave you, they are intended to be a preemptive response that helps you to prepare for some situation that you're anticipating finding yourself in. So for example, your heart beating faster pumps more blood out to your tissues, and your respiration rate increasing brings more oxygen into your body. Both of those things are going to be necessary if you're going to chase after the bus and catch it so that you can make it to class on time.